It's a privilege to have with us today Dmitry Bertsekas. For many years was a professor at MIT. Not many people know this, but he used to be a professor at Stanford as well, back in the day. He's famous for many things he's done, but among others, he's written so many of the textbooks we use. One of them that he wrote with John Sisiglis in the 1990s was a book titled Neurodynamic Programming, which tried to bring together many of the tricks and tools in this area of reinforcement learning and approximate dynamic programming and assemble them in a coherent way to support future work. Now, that area has really taken off in recent years. Things in that book have been put to use to generate all sorts of impressive engineering feats. Some of them made famous by a company, DeepMind, that produced, for example, this system AlphaZero that learns how to play multiple games better than human world champions. Okay, a lot of the ideas there traced back to things that were put together in this book. But beyond that, Dmitry's worked in so many different areas and has won so many different awards. It's hard to go through them, but the von Neumann Award, the Bellman Award, the Danzig Award, etc. So it's a great privilege to have him with us today to tell us about his latest work and thoughts on reinforcement learning and approximate dynamic programming.
Thank you very much, Ben. It's my pleasure to be here at Stanford. That was my first teaching job, and the first course I taught on dynamic programming was here. I also taught a lot of optimization. I really learned optimization here thanks to my proximity with David Leuenberger and the wonderful books that he had written. I taught from these books. And my first course in dynamic programming, and a lot of this work that I'm going to talk today goes back to that early period. I believe it was 1971 or 72. That's so long ago. Reinforcement learning and optimal control. And this is a selective overview based on a book that I'm currently writing. And in the late 80s and early 90s, a wonderful convergence of ideas occurred from artificial intelligence and from decision and control. Each side had important ideas to contribute, and at that point, there was the start of approximations introduced into dynamic programming, which eventually led to a rejuvenation of reinforcement learning and also a new life to dynamic programming, which was getting stale and hampered by inherent difficulties of dimensionality. So let me just go through some thumbnails of historical account. Exact dynamic programming, it goes back to the early 50s and before that. I can mention Bellman and also Shannon, whose work on chess is the progenitor of all chess programs, including the AlphaZero program that has become famous today. The convergence of ideas between artificial intelligence and dynamic programming came to fruition impressively in the early 90s through the work of Tesoro. This is a remarkable way on backgammon programs that learn how to play by playing against themselves and reached superhuman performance level. I got into this field because I was so impressed, in large part because I was so impressed from Tesoro's work. It was really remarkable, and a lot of Tesoro's ideas are incorporated in modified, expanded form in the AlphaZero program that is very much in the news today. So, in the mid-90s, we had algorithmic progress, new algorithms, new analysis, many applications, and the first books. And all of this was accelerated in the 2000s with some mega trends in machine learning, the use of the availability of lots of data, robotics, deep neural networks, and all that. And the recent impressive success is the AlphaGo program and the success of the AlphaZero program, which plays chess and other games, but I'll focus on chess. AlphaZero is very remarkable. It plays much better than all chess programs, but most importantly, it plays different. I'm not a chess master, but I've been a student of chess for all my life, and I can tell you without any reservation that this program is amazingly different, plays amazingly different, and discovers new strategies that are not, that cannot be conceived by humans. So it's really very, very impressive. Another thing that's impressive about it is that it learned from scratch. It was only given the rules of the game, and then by playing against itself, discovered new strategies, openings, ways to play, and played better than all other chess programs within 4 hours of training. So chess is a game of hundreds of years history, and this program learned how to play in 4 hours. And then eventually, over a matter of days, it reached a much higher level. Moreover, the same algorithm that was used to learn chess, it also was also used to learn other games, like Go, Shogi, Japanese version of chess. And so the ideas are portable. They can go from one application to another, at least within the game domain. Now, if you look at the methodology, the AlphaZero program uses policy iteration ideas. Policy iteration is a fundamental method in dynamic programming. It uses simulation-based approximations to policy iteration. And it also uses self-learning in the sense that it generates a sequence of strategies, and each strategy plays games against itself to generate data to obtain an improved strategy. And it also uses the idea of Monte Carlo tree search, policy improvement, as was also an innovation, at least in the game context, and it was important in achieving good performance. Now, none of the ideas in AlphaZero is really new. All of this was known for at least 10 years. However, the success can be attributed to skillful implementation of these ideas, finding the right mix, which is typical of this field. What's important is to be able to combine ideas in the right way. Also, having the awesome computational resources of Google helped a lot. Okay, so here we are, this is the last step. And overall now, looking back, we see a methodology that's both ambitious and universal. It's universal in the sense that it applies in principle to a very broad range of optimization problems. Deterministic to stochastic, combinatorial optimization, discrete optimization, to continuous state and control spaces problems involving the rise in optimal control, one decision maker, or two-player games. However, exact dynamic programming is plagued by the curse of nonlinearity, the computatorial explosion of the amount of memory and computation needed to obtain the exact optimal solution. Moreover, it needs an exact mathematical model. Now, approximate dynamic programming and reinforcement learning overcomes these difficulties in two ways. Through approximation, it uses neural networks or other approximation architectures to reduce the dimension of the problem. And it also uses, you can use simulation so that if you have a computer model, you can use it in place of a mathematical model. The current state of the art is that we have a broadly applicable methodology that can address a very broad range of challenging problems that we never thought that it was possible to address before. Deterministic problems, stochastic problems, dynamic, discrete, continuous games, just about any type of optimization problem can be modeled in terms of dynamic programming, and therefore by extension can be addressed with reinforcement learning. There are many methods in this field. They're a little confusing, and there are no methods that are guaranteed to work for all or even most problems. This is not like linear algebra problems. You don't guarantee that a given algorithm will work on your problem. You have to experiment with a lot of algorithms. However, there are enough methods to try so that you have a reasonable chance of success. You have a chance that at least one of them is going to work on your problem. There is theory here. Some of it is challenging, interesting, exciting, and its role is to guide the art. Still, success on a given problem is a matter of art. The theory guides the art, and it also helps delineate the sound ideas from the one that are sort of crazy, and there's no shortage of crazy ideas in this field. Okay, so my purpose in this talk is to selectively review some of the methods and bring out the connections between artificial intelligence and dynamic programming. And near the end, and I don't know if I have time given that we started late, discuss a few recent ideas on the subject of aggregation. There are quite a few exact dynamic programming books, starting with Bellman's book, which were very important to me. I have a book that came out a year ago called Abstract Dynamic Programming, which is the opposite of the subject of the present talk. It's a mathematical book that deals with exact dynamic programming and aims at algorithmic unification through a mathematical operator formalism. There are quite a few approximate dynamic programming books and also neural networks books. Ben mentioned my book with John Tsitsikin from 1996. The book by Sutton and Barber is very, very popular and came out in 1998, and there's a new edition out that came out last year. And I have a new book that is going to be coming out, I hope, June of this year. And there's a partial draft online, except for one chapter of the book is online. Of course, it's going to be revised between now and June, but you can take a look. And the purpose of the book is to provide not so much new research, but rather a synthesis of the broad mosaic of methods that are available, and so that you can find where within this big picture your problem fits. And there is some new research, but that's not terribly important. The main thing is to construct the big picture of the variety of methods that are available. There are also many other books on the subject by now. There are many surveys. I always like the Soros papers, and the books, the papers on AlphaZero are also very illuminating and very important. Okay, now, there has been a tremendously beneficial cross-fertilization between artificial intelligence and decision control. However, the culture of these two fields is different. And moreover, the terminology is very different. To begin with, reinforcement learning uses maximization of value, whereas control traditionally uses minimization of cost. It's a minor problem, and so you have, instead of a reward of a stage, we have cost of a stage. You just reverse a sign. State value, stage cost, value function versus cost function. However, some fundamental terms have different names. Some fundamental ideas and notions have different names. So for example, a controller or decision maker in decision control is called an agent in reinforcement learning. A control is called an action. A dynamic system, be it discrete time, continuous space, differential equations, whatever, is called environment in reinforcement learning. So in decision control, a decision maker applies controls to influence the trajectory of a dynamic system, whereas in reinforcement learning, an agent chooses actions to affect the environment. That can be quite confusing, and I personally was helped a lot by having a cheat sheet where I could have a translation of the different terms. If you look at my book, there's a glossary and translator of about two pages of different terms that I've used in the two fields. Occasionally, I consult it, and I find it helpful, and you may find it helpful also. Just to give you an idea, the term learning is used a lot in reinforcement learning, as you might imagine, and in decision control, it refers to solving a dynamic-related problem, dynamic programming-related problem, using simulation. Simulation is is connected with learning. Self-learning, or self-play in the context of games. In dynamic programming terms, it involves solving a problem using a simulation-based policy iteration. Self-learning is related to policy iteration. In reinforcement learning, there's a distinction between planning and learning. Planning refers to solving a dynamic programming with a model, having a mathematical model. Learning, it refers to solving a dynamic programming problem with model-free simulation. This is just a small sample of terms. Like I said, I have two pages of translations of different terms, and that has been a bit of a problem in reading the literature. But hopefully, this will be overcome over time. So now, let me tell you, this is a selective overview. So I've selected some topics that will give you an idea, provide some highlights. A fundamental distinction in this field is whether you're doing approximation in value space or policy space. Whether you're approximating the cost function of a problem or you're approximating the policy of a problem. Then I'm going to discuss about general issues of approximation in value space. Say a few things about problem approximation, rollout and model predictive control, parametric approximation and neural networks, and finally, to the extent I have time, I will discuss aggregation. Okay, so let's talk about approximation in value and policy space. Everything I'm going to discuss today will have to do with a finite horizon, non-stationary dynamic programming problem, where you have a system where xk is the state of the system, uk is the control, wk is a random disturbance. This is a random vector, essentially. And this is a system function. It's a discrete time system whose state evolves according to this equation. The state is observed by the controller. Based on the state, an action or control is applied to affect the system that generates the next state, and so on. There's also this random disturbance here. There's a cost for each stage k that depends on state control and disturbance, and the total cost is the sum of the stage cost plus a terminal cost at the final state after n periods. And of course, this is a random quantity. We take the expected value of that to get a number, and this is the cost of the problem. We assume perfect state information. The control is applied with exact knowledge of the state. If you don't have exact knowledge of the state, it's possible to reformulate the problem into one with perfect state information. I'm not going to get into that. And we optimize over feedback policies, functions of state, one function for each time period from 0 to n minus 1. These are rules that specify the control to apply at each possible state that can occur. Now, dynamic programming deals with exactly this problem. And here is the algorithm. It goes backwards from time n to time 0. This is the terminal cost function. That's where we start the algorithm. Given the jk plus 1, we generate jk all the way from n to 0. And jk is of xk. It's a function of the current state. That's time k. Is the optimal cost to go starting from state xk. So you are at time k, and you look at the tail problem from time k to n. And at the state xk, the optimal cost for that problem is this jk xk. And the algorithm generates backwards these functions. On the other hand, doing this computation is enormously complicated. That has traditionally been the difficulty with exact dynamic programming. Now, approximation in value space takes the difficult part, the calculation of this jk plus 1, and approximates it with some j tilde k plus 1. Okay? That's all there is to it. And instead of minimizing that expression, we minimize this expression and get a control to apply at each state xk. So here, we do the dynamic programming minimization, and we treat exactly the cost of the first stage and approximately the remainder. And there's also a multi-step look-ahead version where we look exactly at the first L stages, let's say, and then approximate the future with a J tilde function. So this is a picture that it covers 80% of reinforcement learning fits somewhere within this picture. Approximation in value space with one step look ahead here. We minimize at state xk over all controls this expected value involving exact treatment of the first stage cost and approximate treatment of the remainder. And there are three approximations here. And it's interesting to note that these three approximations can be treated separately. One approximation is to use j tilde k plus 1 in place of j k plus 1, the exact optimal cost to go. And there are a number of methods that we can use to calculate this j tilde. The important problem is, how do you calculate this j tilde? And there is problem approximation. It uses a related problem that is more pliant, more easy to deal with. And in this, and we use as j tilde the optimal cost of the approximate problem. Rollout is an important method, model validity control. The principal method for control system design these days is model validity control. And it's a way to calculate j tildes, roughly speaking. Parametric approximation, using a parametric architecture like a neural network to calculate a j tilde in some way. Aggregation is a problem approximation method that I hope to be able to discuss later. Just about any method for calculating j tilde falls within this list somewhere, with approximations perhaps a mixture of ideas, but it's somewhere in there. Now there are two other approximations here. There's a difficult expected value here. In large problems, the expected value is hard to calculate. So you may want to approximate that. One way to do it is by certainty equivalence. Replace the uncertain quantities with single values, perhaps the mean values. Adaptive simulation tries to save in computation of the expected value by calculating less accurately this expected value for some controls. The ones that seem less promising, you don't need to compute an exact expectation for them. Perhaps you can get by with a smaller effort. Monte Carlo research is also related to adaptive simulation. It's a popular method in some domains. The third approximation is the minimization. Still, you have to minimize over some uk. That uk may take an infinite number of values, so that may be a problem. And you may want to consider discretization. You may want to consider some other tricks that have to do with approximation policy space. I'm going to say a few things about that later. But there are three different approximations, and each one can be combined with the other in ways that may be beneficial in given context. All of this also applies in the case of a multi-step look ahead, where the minimization problem involves exact treatment of the first L stages costs, and then the future is approximated with a j tilde function. And now, this problem here is not a one-stage problem, it's an L-stages problem. In other words, a smaller horizon dynamic programming problem that you can solve for a policy that involves a first control and control functions for the remaining stages. And after you solve this problem at the current state xk, you use the first control and forget about the rest, and go to the next state, and then continue. So, conceptually, there's not much difference between one-step look-ahead and multi-step look-ahead, although if you have multi-step look-ahead, there are some issues to consider that are in addition. I'm going to focus on one-step look-ahead for the remainder. Okay, so now what I'd like to do is selectively go around this picture and give you some ideas of how they can be implemented. But before I do that, I want to talk about some generic aspects of this type of approximation. Okay, there is a distinction between online and offline methods. In offline methods, this j tilde is computed ahead of time, before you apply the first control. You do your calculations today, and then you do the control tomorrow, okay? And examples of offline methods are the neural network and other parametric approximation methods, aggregation is also offline. Online methods calculate J tilde as you go along. Once you have the current state xk, you calculate the possible values of J tilde and the possible next state, and you use those to compute the minimizing control. Online methods are, for example, model validity control and rollout. They offer many conveniences. It's often harder and requires more computation intensive to calculate these J tildes online, but there are some important advantages, and one of them is if the data of the problem changes on you as you go along. For example, you may receive some forecast, they may change the probabilistic structure of the problem, and so on, and then you can do online replanning more easily. With offline methods, you cannot replan when the data of the problem changes midstream. Also, you have to do some online computation of the controls for the case where the number of states is very large. You can't, even if you are able to calculate control suboptimal controls for given states, the number of states may be so large that you can't store them. You have to generate them online. So there's always an online component in these calculations here. Okay, there's a lot of talk about model-based versus model-free implementations. The term model-free is used in so many different ways that I have decided to get away with, to use an implementation model-free that doesn't have to do with models. Okay, so in my terminology, a method is called model-free if it involves calculation of expected values using simulation. Model-free for me is just using simulation. And let me tell you about the main context for which you need to do a model-free implementation. One is when you don't have a mathematical model for the probabilistic structure of the problem, the distribution of the disturbances given a current state of control. You don't have a mathematical model, but instead you have a simulator. There are many problems where indeed it's very easy to construct a computer simulator than to construct no system identification, construct a model of the discrete time equation. So for those contexts, you have to use some kind of a model-free implementation. So this simulator for any state in control, it simulates the transitions to the next state and generates the corresponding transition costs. Now there's another context where you may have a mathematical model, but for reasons of computational efficiency, you prefer to compute an expected value by using sampling. This is the same context where you prefer to approximate an integral with Monte Carlo integration, or approximate a huge sum of numbers by Monte Carlo estimate. Then you would calculate, for example, an expected value that appears in the dynamic programming equation by doing Monte Carlo simulation rather than doing some kind of summation over the alternatives. There are also other contexts for this. Okay, let me say one more thing about model-free implementation. Suppose that you have a J tilde function that you have computed in some way, and I'm not going to specify it further. You can implement an approximation of a Q factor on top of J tilde. And what do we mean by this? We have a training set that we construct a training set of state control and Q factor triplets. This Q factor is the right hand side of the approximation equation, and then we fit a function Q tilde to this set. And now, if we want to, and now this can be done by using a simulator, and therefore the Q factor approximation can be done in a model-free fashion, and of course it can be used to generate controls by minimization over U. So you can view this as approximation in policy space on top of approximation in value space. And this J tilde is generated in a model free fashion. Also, the whole scheme is model free. Okay, so let me say a few things about the remaining 20%. I said 80% is value, roughly speaking. 80% is approximation in value space. The remaining 20% is approximation in policy space. And the framework is the following. Instead of computing J tildes, you compute mu tildes. This mu tilde is a parametric form of a policy, and it involves a certain parameter r. So we parameterize policies with, a parameter vector r, and every r defines a policy. And the idea now is to optimize a measure of performance with respect to r. Once you stick in a mu tilde for a given r in here, you generate a cost that's a function of r. So it makes sense to minimize that cost with respect to R. It's direct minimization with respect to the parameters of the controller. Now, one important advantage here is that if you manage to do this optimization, the online computation of controls is typically easier. All you have to do is a neural network. It involves a number of weights R here. You have a certain state. You feed the state into this neural network and it spits out the controller. Very easy to implement. It's a different kind of methodology than approximation to value space. And there are several contexts where you would prefer to do that. And I have five possibilities here. The first one is problems where that admit a natural policy parameterization. For example, in inventory control, supply chain problems, the optimal policy or good policies are come in the form of thresholds. In other words, buy inventory up to that threshold, start ordering inventory if it falls below that threshold, and so on. So if you know the thresholds, you know good policies, and the parameters are going to be the thresholds. You optimize with respect to thresholds. It's a viable approach that has been used with success. The second possibility is approximation in policy space on top of approximation in value space. Is the what I explained in the previous slide. Train in value space, and then use a neural network to learn the local head policy that corresponds to that trained approximation. There are also some problems where that admit natural value parameterizations, but then when you try to obtain a policy, it's just easier to use a policy space method, like a policy gradient or some kind of a random search method. Here's another interesting context. Suppose that you have a given problem, and you have some expert, human expert, that knows how to make reasonably good decisions. Or you may have some software, heuristic software or whatever software, that also can make some decisions from you. You can try to emulate the policy that the expert uses by using samples of his decisions. States, expert decisions, fit a policy to what he decides. And that can be useful in a number of contexts. It's not as ambitious as trying to find the optimal policy or a good suboptimal policy. You can only do as well as the human expert does. However, in a pinch, that's good. That may be good. Okay, one more context. Approximation value space requires a conventional dynamic programming information structure. In other words, perfect state information, and the controller has access to all of it, doesn't forget any of it, and so on. In multi-agent systems, you may have local information. Some of the agents may have more information than others that pertain to their locality. And they may not be sharing this information, or they may be sharing with some delay. This type of problem does not fit the dynamic programming framework, but it does fit the approximation policy space framework. So approximation policy space gives you an approach for this type of problems. Okay, let's say a few things about problem approximation. So here's our picture. Let's look at problem approximation. J tilde k plus 1 here is the exact cost to go of a simpler problem. Okay, you simplify the dynamics, you get rid of all the stochastic uncertainties, you get a simpler problem that's tractable, and then you use its optimal cost function as your J tilde. And there are many problem-dependent possibilities. Probabilistic approximation, certainty equivalence, an old approach that dates back to the 60s. Replace stochastic quantities by deterministic ones to make the look-ahead minimization deterministic, okay? Getting rid of the expected values in the minimization, that's a big thing. Approximate the expected values by limited simulation, sort of related. In the many large-scale problems, we have coupled subsystems, and you may want to use an approach that minimizes one subsystem at a time. An easier optimization that will give you a J tilde that you can use for the overall problem. There may be coupling through constraints. You may artificially decompose the constraints and get easier problems to approximate with the original. Lagrange relaxation and aggregation is also a problem approximation approach. You group states together and view the groups as aggregate states. You collapse similar states together and get a smaller dimensional problem, aggregation, roughly speaking. Okay, so let me say a few things about another popular approach, rollout and volume protective control. Rollout is a very simple technique, and I should add, it's probably the simplest to implement and the most reliable out of all the reinforcement learning approaches. It just works every time. It's very simple to implement. And what it does, it's less ambitious. What it does, it starts with some policy, some reasonable policy, which we call the base policy. Can be anything, and may be obtained by a different method. You may obtain a base policy by running an elaborate procedure involving neural networks and so on. Or you may obtain very simplistic, in a very simplistic way. Then the objective of rollout is to improve on that base policy. For those of you who are familiar with policy iteration, rollout is basically a one-step policy iteration on the current, on the base policy. And here is a figure that describes rollout in a generalized form. It involves three parts. You are at the current state, and you want to choose a control. You can choose this control or that control, and then get into state xk plus 1. And then if you use multi-step look ahead, there may be a long, there will be a longer, a deeper tree, states xk plus 2, and so on. A number of stages of look ahead, perhaps one, perhaps more. Then from each leaf of this tree, you run the base policy, you simulate it, and you obtain a number. However, this base policy may have to be run for a large number of states, so it may be useful to truncate the rollout up to a certain number of steps, and then take a terminal cost function approximation. And this J tilde may be obtained by any of a number of methods, neural network methods, all kinds of different, just anything goes for J tilde, and anything goes for this base policy, and you have this multi-step look ahead. So that's the form of rollout, and there are a lot of parameters, structural parameters to play with. Terminal cost function approximation, and there's an important theoretical fact here, that on which the success of rollout is couched on this fact. With exact look ahead, and no terminal cost function approximation, the rollout policy improves over the base policy. Sometimes it will improve dramatically. Sometimes it will improve not so dramatically, but quite a bit. The typical experience is that the improvement is quite substantial. And it may occur also even if the base policy is not very good. That's an experimentally observed fact. What you can prove is only that you are not going to make things worse. Okay? It doesn't tell you how much you're going to improve. Okay, this assumes that this box does not exist here. However, there are also additional results that are related. Rollout policy improves approximately on the base policy, depending on assumptions of this J tilde. Okay, so now, like I said, this is realized in practice. You do this in practice, it works almost every time, and oftentimes very well. Now, model predictive control is a special case of rollout, and let me explain why. If you look at this figure, it implicitly assumes that there's a finite number of controls at each step. Okay, here there are two controls. However, you may have problems where there's an infinite number of controls. So when the control space is infinite, what do you do with rollout? You need a different implementation. One possibility is to discretize the control space, okay? So obtain a look-ahead tree, a finite look-ahead tree in place of this continuous optimization, but then you need an excessive number of discretization points, excessive number of Q factors computed to compare, and so on. So this is may not be a good option. The alternative is to use a base heuristic, a base policy that's based on optimization itself. So here is the first stage optimization, and then there's the L stages look ahead, and you use some kind of base policy that's itself an optimization. So now, to obtain the control at state xk, you need to optimize over the first stage and the remaining stages, and you can conflate the two optimizations into one seamlessly, combine the k-stage optimization, the optimization of the heuristic, over a single L-stages optimization. And then this becomes, for continuous space control problems, becomes a type of problem that can be solved by nonlinear programming, like quadratic programming. Or gradient techniques can be used to solve this optimization. This is the standard form of the standard approach on which model predictive control is based. Okay, so let's look at model predictive control. Okay, control, there are two types of problems basically. Mainly, one is regulation problem, where you try to keep the state of a system around some set point. And the other is trajectory following problem. You try to keep the trajectory of the system around a certain trajectory. So let's talk about a regulation problem where we try to keep the state of the system near the origin. At state xk, model predictive control tries to bring optimally the state of the system L steps ahead to zero. Instead of hovering around the origin, we specify that the state will be set to zero L steps ahead. And this applies for the deterministic problem now. Okay, typically the cost per stage is not negative. The origin is cost-free and absorbing. So this problem here becomes a relatively tractable problem. Now the motivation for model predictive control is that in this minimization, you can take into account explicitly the state constraints and the control constraints. There are many problems where you have to observe the constraints. You can't let a chemical plant perhaps move over certain temperature boundaries because it will blow up on you. Linear quadratic type of approaches, which are popular in control, do not work for problems like that, because a quadratic penalty on the state is a soft, enforces the constraint softly. What you need is the constraints to be observed in a hard way. And this optimization can be done by observing these constraints exactly. That's the big selling point of model predictive control. That was the motivation for starting chemical process control, because they had hard constraints that they had to enforce, and linear quadratic type of control formulations did not work. So, now we are in rollout land. At xk, we solve an L-step look-ahead version of the problem, requiring that the terminal state is equal to zero, while satisfying the control and the state constraints. And In solving this problem, we obtained a sequence of L controls, and we apply the first one. And then we move to the next state, do the same thing, and so on. It's an online method with an L-step optimization at each step. Okay. Let's say a few things about neural networks and deep neural networks. Neural network is a magical term these days. Just add the term deep in front of it, it becomes exciting. Let's look at the multi-step look ahead approximation in value space with a parametric approximation. So J tilde k will come from a class of functions parameterized by this parameter vector rk, which is tunable. You use data to calculate suitable values of this rk. Basically, you sample state and cost pairs and do a least squares fit, some kind of regression. That's the typical way you calculate this rk parameters. And two major types of approximation architectures are the linear feature-based architecture and the neural network architecture. In central to all these is the notion of a feature. Given a state, there are some important characteristics of the states. We can listen in a relatively short vector of features. And you have a feature extraction mapping that produces these functions of the state. And the idea here is that these features will capture a lot of the nonlinearity that's involved in J tilde xk, so that you can represent a good approximation of that by linearly weighing the features of the state. So this is in a product of a weight vector with a feature vector, and what you try to do is by training, determine this value here using a linear least squares problem, which is nice because linear least squares problems have unique solutions. They can be solved actually exactly by even MATLAB. Even though that's not necessarily the best way to do it, because the regression may involve a large number of terms. But in principle, you can do it by MATLAB. The alternative, okay, so if you have features, it's great. If they're sufficient, you don't want to go further. However, in many problems, features, good features are not available. And that's where neural networks come in. Neural networks automatically construct features. That's the big thing about neural networks. In the context of dynamic programming, there's no other benefit that neural networks give. They construct features to represent costs. And here's how they work. Okay, you have a state, x or y. You first encode the state in some kind of a vector that's suitable as input to a neural network. And the neural network consists of a linear layer involving a matrix A and a vector B. And these are unknown. These are parameters to be determined. And then the vector that comes here at the output is passed through a nonlinearity, one-dimensional nonlinearity, each component of this term here, and produces features at the end. These are numbers for a state I and a vector v that represents the weights here. They produce a set of features. These features are linearly weighted. At this point, you treat the result as a linear feature-based architecture. You weigh linearly the features, and out you obtain a cost approximation that's a linear combination of the features, which you have, however, automatically constructed by data. Where does the data come from? Well, you give state cost pairs, and you try to fit this neural network, find the parameters, try to fit to the data. So neural networks are approximation architectures of this form here, involving parameter vectors R and V. V are the weights of the network. And R and V have different roles. V sub XV you can view as a feature vector, and R is viewed as the vector of linear weights for the features. But by training these jointly with R, we automatically obtain both the features and the weights for that. Okay. I guess I forgot to put here a slide on deep neural networks. But they are so simple that I can describe them to you just by talking. There's nothing deep about neural networks. They're just more of those. All of these together. And this fact was known since the early days of neural networks, since the 60s. And the people have tried them. They just involve more complicated structures. At that time, the computation resources were not so plentiful or strong, and people were using mostly one or two layers. But it's possible, in principle, to use many layers. It turns out that there are some advantages in some settings. And deep neural networks involving multiple concatenations of linear and nonlinear layers, and also structuring of nonlinear layers, they have scored some big successes. In the late 2000s, image processing, speech processing, and also they have been used in the AlphaZero program. There are people speculate about why they work better in some contexts. And this speculation may have basis in fact, but it's not a solid speculation. Nobody really knows why deep neural networks work better for some applications and not for others. Tesoro, in his early 90s work, tried one layer, two layers, and three layers, and found that one layer was better for him. Okay? And in fact, backgammon programs that are descendants of Tesoro's work now use one layer. Okay? You can find them on the internet. They use like 250 weights, and that's all. It's adequate for the purposes of training a backgammon program. However, now there's more powerful software. There's standardized software that's available, TensorFlow. That's a good and reliable software that can deal with the complexities of multiple layer neural networks. Okay. Okay, so let me mention some topics that I have not covered. Infinite horizon extensions. Approximate policy derivation. Policy derivation, a measure method for infinite horizon problems. All of these ideas of self-learning, various variants like optimistic multi-step policy derivation. Temporal difference methods is an important topic in the policy for evaluating policies in the context of infinite horizon policy iteration. It has a rich theory. Mathematicians like temporal difference methods. And there are a number of interesting issues to deal with here, and will not deal with that in this talk. Exploration is a major topic in the context of policy iteration. A lot of work is going on, both here and also in other places. It has always been an important issue of balancing exploration and exploitation in the context of policy iteration. Monte Carlo research has been used in game context particularly and has been very successful. I haven't talked about that. Q-learning is an important term, an important method that can be used with and without approximations. Various approximation policy space methods, actor critics methods, policy gradient, gross entropy, random search methods. There is a large literature of these. Imperfect state information problems, where you don't have exact access to the exact value of the state. Deterministic problems often have very redeeming features which manifest themselves in the facility for computing shortest paths. There's more that I don't even have space to list. The field is very broad by now. And I'm afraid I'm going to have to skip the ideas of aggregation. I by the way, fundamental work on aggregation was done by Ben Van Rooy and by co-author Jan Stiglitz. In Error Bounds, 1995, Error Bounds and Value and Policy Duration Convergence. There are some new ideas on aggregation that you will find in the internet, in my book page and so on. So I'm going to stop here. Oh, there's one more thing. Spatial-temporal aggregation. This is something, if you haven't heard the term spatial-temporal aggregation, I don't blame you because I made it up 2 months ago, okay? And the idea was to do aggregation not only in space but also in time. If you think about it, when you travel from east to west coast and you plan your trip, you don't plan every detail of the trip, but rather you compress the trip into time, a number of days, and you plan also where you want to be at the end of each day. So that's compression in space and also in time. And there is a way to formalize this in the context of particular deterministic problems, but also stochastic problems. So let me conclude here. Artificial intelligence and reinforcement learning have taken over. However, it's important to keep in mind some words of caution. There are no foolproof methods, and there are challenging implementation issues in all approaches. You may need domain-specific knowledge, particularly if you want to use problem approximation and feature selection. Features are based on problem on domain-specific knowledge. Training algorithms, backpropagation, policy gradient, all that, they are not as reliable as people would want you to believe, okay? They're just flaky methods, in my opinion. I grew up at a time when the objective in optimization was how to avoid using gradient methods. Now everybody wants to use gradient methods. I can't fully understand that, although for neural networks, they do offer some advantages and have scored successes. Approximate policy duration issues of exploration, there are also installation issues, they have their challenges. How do you know that you have succeeded? You get a suboptimal policy, but you don't know where the optimal is. So determining whether you have succeeded or failed can be a challenge. In game context, there have been spectacular successes, as highlighted by AlphaZero. However, they have benefited from perfectly known and stable models. And the rules of chess do not change from one game to the next, and also the number of moves in any one position is relatively small. It's not infinite, it's relatively small. Problems of partial space state observation also are challenging because you have to work with belief spaces and belief spaces are dimensional and so on. Let me mention, I read an article you may find on the internet by Steven Strogatz, who is a professor of mathematics at Cornell, and wrote an op-ed article in December of 2018, and you may read it. He says that what's frustrating about machine learning is that we don't know why it works. A lot of details are hidden under the hood, and we don't know if they can be trusted as a result. You get some numbers, but how do you know? There's no intuition in understand that will help you understand why a particular machine learning algorithm for a large big data problem will work or not. And he predicts that this is going to be a source of tension in our future interactions with computers. I think it's worth thinking about this. Okay, so now let me, having given you all these words of caution, let me give you some optimistic assessment. We can rely on more available massive computation power and distributed computational advances to do a lot of these computations that are involved in reinforcement learning. Like, for example, simulation can be done very, very easily in parallel. The practical optimization problems that we can address now are of unimaginable difficulty. I never thought that I would see chess programs playing as well as they have been, or huge, difficult problems being addressed. We can't solve all these problems, but we have now a methodology to begin to address them. So, all in all, there's an exciting journey ahead, and we can all rejoice in that. Thank you very much.
We'll take a couple of questions.
Yes. Hi, Professor. Very interesting talk. You mentioned that neural networks have the advantage that you don't have to specify the features they will extract it. On the same note, you also said that feature selection is a very difficult sector. So did you mean that neural networks are good for feature extraction in the value space, and then you have to still do feature selection in the policy space, or did you mean something else?
Okay. In the value space, they do it automatically. You don't have to worry. Okay. Perhaps you have to work. If you have some features, you can add them as input to the neural network. The state encoding may be also another thing to play with. In approximation policy space, when you use a neural network, it may be important to know how, it's more difficult, it may be important to know how to structure the neural network.
Okay. Andrea?
So I wanted to push back a little bit on your comment about insight. So I'll tell a short anecdote, which is when Stephen Hoy gave the plenary at the Information Theory Symposium about 20 years ago, someone in the audience got up at the end of his talk and said, well, you know, information theorists, we do closed form solution and we get a lot of insight. And what does dynamic programming tell you about insight? Because it just gives you some policy. So people say the same thing about dynamic programming. Now, you could argue it's trusted because you know that you're getting the optimal solution. But I would say, why do you get more insight out of a dynamic program than out of something that comes out of a neural net or even a deep neural net?
Whenever there's approximation, there's always a question of how well you're doing. And like I said, it's hard to know when you have succeeded. It is a dynamic programming algorithm is a little bit more transparent than a neural network. I look at a neural network and I get lost, you know? I don't know what it's doing. In the dynamic programming, you can see a stage-wise structure. The variables that are involved, they are not weights that are meaningless to the outside observer, but they are states and controls. So you can tell that at this stage, well, the control does not look so unreasonable. You can get some insight out of suboptimal solution, although certainly this is not a replacement for having the exact solution for which you have a sense of certainty that it's good. So that's one difference that I see, but I agree with you that it's not insight. Also, lack of insight is a problem even in approximate dynamic programming.
One more?
Simple question. Exploration is a major area in reinforcement learning. Where does it appear in dynamic programming? What's the analog? Does dynamic programming teach us anything about how to do it?
I don't know of a way to deal with exploration in the context of dynamic programming insights. Okay. Basically, exploration has to do with collecting enough data from all important parts of your control space. When you're updating policies, it's important to base this update on information that's collected from all the relevant parts of the state space. Now, how do you cover this part of the state space is something that we really don't know how to do. This is a subject of ongoing research. People have been dealing with this question for at least 20 years, and it's still an unresolved problem.
Thank you very much.